I have to approach my photography in a completely different way than I would have to with any other camera. And it really is just nice to like stretch your brain in that way.
Hey everyone, and welcome to another conversation where we get in depth about the products that you want to know about. We are talking vintage cameras, and joining me is senior editor Eric Limer. Eric, thanks for coming on and talking with me.
Thanks, my pleasure. I love to talk about vintage cameras.
Good. Well, you're
having a hard time stopping me.
Good. That's what I like to hear. So why don't we start by you just telling the audience a little bit about yourself and what you do for Gear Patrol.
Cool. Yeah, I'm a senior editor at Gear Patrol. Historically, I've covered a lot of the tech stuff. More recently, I'm covering a lot of how-tos and explainers across all the desks. I would say the places where my particular like pre-existing hobby interests overlap with Gear Patrol most particularly are vintage cameras and film stuff. That's a pretty new thing for me. Got into that in the past couple of years, but got in real deep. And then I'm sort of a pre-existing keyboard nerd. I've got like three or four keyboards here, and sort of a recovering knife guy. I haven't bought a new knife in a while, but I've got like I don't know, like 15 or 16 hanging around the house. So those are the main ones.
Yeah, I was lucky enough to sit near you when we were in the office still, and I really did enjoy that clickety-clack of those mechanical keyboards. That was nice. So as far as, you know, your background in photography, what got you started in photography, and what kind of cameras were you using at first, and then what got you into specifically vintage cameras?
Yeah, so what did get me into photography? So I had the opportunity about maybe at this point 5 or 6 years ago to borrow a friend's Nikon DSLR and just like sort of putzed around with it. Was just like goofing around, sort of a thing that you'll discover like the first time you pick up a DSLR compared to shooting photos with a phone. Is doing shallow depth of field. You just open that aperture all the way up and you get that beautiful, like creamy bokeh. I don't know how to say it, but you get that creamy background, right? And that's really intoxicating early on. And so from there, I got, for digital cameras, I've always been a Micro Four Thirds guy. So for folks who aren't familiar with that, Micro Four Thirds is a very small and actually it's a high resolution sensor. It's a high enough resolution sensor for whatever you need, but it's a lot lower resolution than like full frames, but it's cheaper and it's more portable or whatever. So I got a Olympus Micro Four Thirds, which was my daily driver for a while. And then I just got really interested in photo composition and stuff, in part because it's so different from writing. Like, yeah, I've been a professional, you know, wordsmith of some sort for like 10 years at this point. And I got really into photography because it's just completely different. And it's a real nice separation from editing a story of like going and trying to compose real life. So part of what got me into vintage photography was being pulled into the orbit of our big vintage photography buying guide and the other sort of film and film camera nerds who have been in Gear Patrol's orbit at various times. And so I got my first film camera, late 2019. And it wasn't long from there before I got several more and started developing black and white film in my bathroom and sort of went off the deep end from there.
Yeah, that's cool to hear about. Yeah, I've dabbled in photography in the past. We had like just a Canon DSLR that I loved to use a lot, but that's really the only camera that I ever used. So I have very little frame of reference for even what differentiates a vintage camera. Obviously, I have an idea of just how they work so functionally different, but generally speaking, what is it that you would say is different about vintage cameras that, you know, sets them apart from a camera that you would get today? How have they changed over the years and what really marks like a vintage camera?
Yeah. So, I mean, the big thing about a vintage camera is it's film. And that is what there are little pockets of people who are interested in vintage digital cameras, but that's a very small niche thing. The main appeal of getting a vintage camera is working with film. And the main appeal of working with film is that it is just a completely different workflow. There are people who will argue for the, like, this is less and less common, but there was for a while when digital cameras were first coming out, there were people who would argue for, like, the technical superiority of film, right? Because the way film works, because it's an analog format instead of a digital format, a digital picture is a bunch of pixels. There is a discrete number of pixels, a concrete number of pixels in any digital photo. Film is an analog medium, so it's like, well, there's kind of as much detail in there as you can pull out and as the quality of a lens can render onto the actual the film itself. It's this whole different animal. Anyway, to bring it back around, though, the appeal of film, to me at least, and I think to a lot of people, is like, there is a common thing that you do, that most people do when they take photos with a digital camera, whether it's a DSLR or just their phone, which I've heard some photographers refer to as chimping, because it makes you look like sort of like a monkey, the way a monkey would use a camera, which is that you take a bunch of photos and then you're sort of like hunched over and you immediately look at your you look at your picture, right? And so there's a lot of guess and check to the way you can do photography with a digital camera, which is great. It's really useful, especially for people who are just learning how to do photography, to be able to play with settings and then take a picture and then look at it and then change the settings, take another picture and sort of do this back and forth. Film is completely different, right? You sort of eyeball it, you take the shot, and then, you know, the advantage of developing your own film is you can shoot a roll of film and you can find out what it looks like that night. That's pretty much the quickest turnaround that you can get, right? But it's a very different way of approaching photography. It sort of forces you to, it forces me to abandon notions of perfection, because it's just sort of like, I'm not going to be able to perfect the shot. I can only take so many pictures. Every picture you take on film costs money, right? Because you have to buy the film. So you're like, I'm spending 50 cents a shot, depending on the film or whatever. And it sort of just makes you have a different relationship. And it also really forces and rewards you to be really thoughtful about, like, what you're composing. It's just a completely different sort of approach. And so that's the one thing that's appealing to me. The other thing about vintage cameras, less so now because they're getting more popular, so the prices are going up. But for a while there, you could buy a killer film camera for dirt cheap. It's still sort of the case. Like, you know, the best film cameras that I have cost between like $300 and $400. And they're sort of the middle of the road. But like, you know, a digital camera is going to cost you, a good digital camera is going to cost you at least $1,000. And so there's still sort of a smaller upfront expenditure to buy a really nice digital camera. But then there's a larger ongoing expenditure because you're paying for film and you're paying for development and, you know, all of that. But I would say those are the two main things.
Yeah. And I'd say, you know, in an increasingly digital world, there's definitely a romantic element to having something, you know, analog, and the physical aspect of like film photos, I think, is really attractive. I want to get into vintage cameras and film photography. What is the camera that you would point them to as the best entry level starting point? Where would you recommend someone start?
Yeah. So I would say that the best place to start is if you're just looking to start in shooting film and you're not sure how much you're going to commit to it, a like good to decent point and shoot that you can find for like $100 or under is typically the place that you want to go. So my first camera was a and it's one of the ones on our list, an Olympus XA2. So it's a very simple point shoot camera. It has what's called zone focus. So basically the only thing that you have to control with it is a little switch that basically you say, is the subject near to me, in the middle distance, or very far away. And it sort of like guesses at the focus. So there's a very, like, that's a very film thing to me of having to do the zone focus and being like, is this picture really in focus? Depends on my ability to guesstimate whether something is 2 meters or 5 meters away. You'll take that and you'll play around with that and you'll shoot a couple fun rolls of film that have some great shots, some bad shots, hopefully some happy accidents, because that's the best part of of film. And then after you've finished playing with a point and shoot like that, you will either be left wanting more, in which case you can dive deeper, or not, which is also, like, you know, it's totally normal too. And the other thing is that you can go buy, you can still buy and get developed sort of, like, you know, the disposable cameras. That's fun to do as well. The thing about those is, like, they're optically, like, trash. You really have to be like, I'm taking bad photos with this camera, but I'm going to have fun with it.
Yeah.
And if that hooks you, you know, maybe go a little bit deeper.
Yeah. And I'm seeing, you know, there's not one price for any of these because they're vintage, but yeah, I'm seeing like 50, 60 bucks for this Olympus XA2, which feels like a nice low barrier of entry for someone that's looking to get started. As far as our, like, top pick that we recommend, we have the Yashica T4. Am I saying that right, Yashica?
Yes. Yeah, I think so. Yeah. You're saying it as right as I know to say it, yeah.
Good. Okay. Well, what can you tell me about that camera?
Yeah, so this is, like, the sort of... So for the use case I just described of just being, like, I want to mess around with film and I want it to be relatively simple, this is the camera that, like, you do that... And it's going to look amazing. Because so the thing about the T4 is that it is a fairly computerized camera. It has autofocus, whatever. Has a great lens. So it's just a great film point and shoot that is capable of taking fantastic pictures. You don't have to know. You don't have to be, like, setting the aperture manually. You don't have to be, like, guessing distance to focus. The user experience of it is very similar to... you know, sort of shooting with a digital camera. The downside to it is one of those cameras that, like I've described before, it's computerized, has a lot of computerized parts. The prices on the T4 has really gone up because of, you know, because it's easy to use and great. And that's something that's probably going to continue to happen because the supply of T4s is going to go down as these old cameras break, and they're essentially unrepairable. It's the top pick because it's just like, if you're looking for image quality and ease of use shooting film, like, the T4 is the place to go for it.
Yeah, interesting. Yeah, I'm seeing prices ranging from $350 to $470, somewhere in that area. It's funny how much these fluctuate from different sellers.
Yeah.
And I guess different, like, how good condition they are probably plays a factor into that.
Prices will fluctuate also depending on specific instances of, like, whether a camera has been tested or not. So you can get a good deal on a film camera when people are like, as is, like, go nuts.
Sure.
And then you have that also very vintage film experience of being like, all right, I'm taking all these pictures. I'm going to try to put some work into them. But, like, God knows if these pictures are even going to come out because, like, I don't know if this camera works. But that's part of the fun.
Yeah, totally. So if you had one more camera that you would recommend or you feel like should be on people's radar, what would you throw out there?
All right, I've got one here. So this is a Yashica mat. And this really, like, embodies the sort of opposite of what I was talking about with the point and shoot. This is like a film-ass film camera, and it's big and heavy and slow. And it's kind of a pain in the ass to use.
And it looks like that.
It's very weird. It looks like this, which actually the fact that it looks like this is great. If you've ever had the experience of, like, people sort of looking at you weird because you're walking around with a camera and, like, taking pictures of shit, nobody looks at you weird when you're, like, well, some people are, like, attracted to this camera, but it's very non-threatening. So the way this camera works, because it's, so this is what's called a twin lens reflex. It has these two lenses because one is the lens you look through and one is the lens that actually shoots onto the film. And it shoots medium format film, which is instead of little 35 millimeter strips, it's big six centimeter by 6 centimeter squares. So it's like really high resolution, beautiful pictures. But the way that it looks is you look through this viewfinder at the top, and it's essentially like a big periscope. So you're looking from you're looking down at this camera that's shooting at waist height, because the way the mirrors work, you're actually seeing a mirror image of the picture that you will take. So if you want to move your framing to the right, you have to move to the left because you're looking in a mirror. And it's fully manual. So you have to set the, you have to set the aperture, the shutter speed, all of that yourself. This one doesn't have a light meter. So I use my phone to like meter the scene. It is very slow and laborious. But that's what I love about it. It's completely, this is like as different of an experience from shooting a digital camera that you can get. And for it, you also get these giant, beautiful negatives that look, I won't get into the nerdery of it, but medium format film has different, has all sorts of different qualities to it because of the relationship of the piece of film to the lens. So if you're a nerd, like shooting medium format film is just this thing that is so different from digital. There are medium format digital cameras, but they cost like $10,000 and up, $10,000 on the low side. But that camera cost me, I think, $300. And it's definitely one of my favorites, just because whenever I bring it out, I have to approach my photography in a completely different way than I would have to with any other camera. And it really is just nice to like stretch your brain in that way.
Yeah. Well, I knew we were talking vintage cameras. That definitely looks like something that you'd put a cloth over yourself
and
have a flash that explodes. But that's really cool. It's really a cool look. And I'm sure that it takes some pretty interesting photos. But for developing the film, when you finish your roll, what does that look like in 2022? Obviously you can't go to a drugstore anymore and have them developed. So where do you find yourself going?
Yeah. So when our office was in New York, there was a place in Manhattan that would develop film that was a walk from our office. I live in New Jersey and there actually is a film development place. It's like 30, 40 minutes away. For most people, the most practical thing is mail development. There are a couple of websites. I think one of them is Darkroom. Yes, the Darkroom, I think. There are a lot of places that have like a lab somewhere, and you can mail them your film. They will develop it, send you scans, and send you your film back. And so the other thing that you can do is you can develop film at home. It's possible, and dare I say even easy, to develop black and white film at home. It is more complicated, but still pretty feasible to develop C41 color film at home. I've done that before. Stopped doing that just because it wasn't worth my while. Black and white chemicals are really shelf stable, so it's easy to just like do it whenever you want. If you're developing color film, you sort of have to be developing a lot of it on a regular basis in order for it to make sense. But yeah, so basically you send it to a lab, and then you can either pay them to scan it, or if you're going to do a lot of it and you want to save some money, you can buy scanners of various qualities. I have a $200 scanner that paid for itself in like, I don't know, a dozen rolls of film or so, because usually the cost to scan it is, usually the cost to develop is around $10, and the cost to get high resolution scans is around $10. So you can save some money that way. It's mostly mailing, which is convenient, but it takes a long time.
Right. Now for the film that you're using, I have to imagine that they're producing less of it. And I also understand there's a large, you know, there's a lot of variables to the type of film that you have, and it has produces different effects for the photos. Can you briefly speak to that? Maybe just give an overview of like what getting film looks like and what types of film you should know about.
Yeah. So it's one of those things where they were making a lot less film when everybody moved to digital, but now they're starting, It's a little bit of both, right? So some companies, like I believe Kodak is actually spinning up production on a lot of its film. Actually, so one of the main, you know, if you're a 90s kid and you think of a film photo, you think of this like really warm, like color hue, you're probably thinking of Kodak Gold. And for recently, Kodak Gold was only available in 35 millimeter. And Kodak just started offering gold in 120, which are those big negatives I was talking about. So like they're introducing, it's the same film stock, but they were like, here, we're offering this, we're doing a new thing, right? So there is still a lot of film around. It's more expensive and it tends to be like, it's sort of getting more expensive. And the budget stuff is getting more expensive, and well, I don't know, it's all getting more expensive. What isn't getting more expensive, right? But there are some budget film options which are fun to use. Black and white is just, you know, we think of black and white as being like antiquated, of being like pre-color, you know, which is true to a certain extent. But like black and white is also just like really convenient in a lot of ways, because of its optical characteristics, because it's easier to develop. Paying to get black and white developed will sometimes cost you more because it's not that common. Most people develop it themselves. But black and white film is a great thing to get into, I think. So yeah, I would say like the main things that people are into shooting, I would say, are Kodak films. There's Kodak Gold, which is sort of the budget. There's Kodak Portra, which is a professional grade film that's balanced for portraiture. And then there's Kodak Ektar, which is a really bright, a really like color saturated film that's meant to emulate slide film, which is a whole other conversation. So the Kodak lineup is there. The other thing that I think is fun, it's pretty expensive even for film, like I'll circle back around to that, is there's a company called Cinestill that basically they take movie film and prepare it in the way that you would need in order to shoot it in a camera. And it has all kinds of fun characteristics. Like fluorescent lights sort of show up red, and there's some like weird, there's a lot of weird happy accident cinematic feel for that. But it's definitely on the expensive side as far as film goes. You'll pay like $15 a roll, which is on the high end. I would say like if you're buying, it's been a while since I bought film because I bought a ton and now I just have a ton that I need to shoot through.
Nice.
But like if you're buying like in bulk, you can maybe get a roll of, you know, black and white film, of good black and white film for like $6 or $7. You can get some really budget stuff for like $4 or $5 a roll. But then you're sort of rolling the dice. But again, this is something that you should pretty much just buy online. Adorama, gotcha. B&H Photo. Like you were saying before, you're not just going to find film at a local drugstore anymore.
Right. Yeah. Well, obviously, this is a category that goes very deep, and we can't, you know, get into everything. But I think we've covered the bases here more or less. Is there any parting words of advice or wisdom that you would like to impart to anyone looking to get into film photography or vintage cameras?
I mean, I think the only thing is it'd be like if you're like on the edge, like try it. The thing about a vintage camera is that, you know, they aren't making them anymore, and it is sort of getting more popular. So I would never recommend somebody buy a vintage camera as an investment. But the thing is if you buy a vintage camera, specifically if you pay more for one that you know in fact works, and then you don't want it anymore, you can turn around and sell it for probably as much as you bought it for. You might be able to turn a profit. The one thing like you have to be careful of, if you're anything like me, is you justify purchasing a lot of cameras that way, and then you can't part with them. I have at least 5 cameras on my shelf that I bought being like, well, I'm going to sell this when I get a different camera to replace this one in my lineup. And no, I just have both. So, but yeah, I would say dive in. The water's great.
Yeah. Cool. Well, thank you so much for coming on. I really appreciate you taking the time.
Yeah. Yeah. My pleasure.
Thanks for watching. You can learn more about the products we talked about in this video by clicking the links in the description below and checking out our buying guide over at gearpatrol.com. If you like this video and want to stay in the loop on all of our buying advice, tips, and tricks, follow us by hitting the subscribe button and notification bell. It's free and it helps us a lot.